Welcome to Libraries Today. This program is intended to recognize and highlight the unexpected ways local libraries serve their communities today. I'm your host, Stan Howe. Since it was founded by the state legislature in 1929, the West Virginia Library Commission has supported public libraries by providing federal and state monies, professional development, a statewide internet network, and other essential services to 172 public libraries in the state. It's a big job, and an important one. The WVLC also plays a vital role in delivering library services to some of the most at-risk citizens in the state. The WVLC Special Services Department offers direct library services to West Virginians who cannot utilize standard size print because of blindness, visual impairment, or disability. Residents who can't see well or at all depend on special services for talking book machines, audiobooks, braille books, audio newspapers and magazines, and more. It's a daily chore to keep visually challenged residents reading. So let's take a look at just how the WVLC Special Services Department makes a difference in the lives of people who need lots of help to enjoy the magic of a library. We're here in the home of the West Virginia Library Commission, the Culture Center here in Charleston. We're in the lower level of the building, which houses, among other things, the WVLC Special Services team. With me now is Special Services Librarian Jasmine Lewis Combs. Jasmine, thanks for being with us.
You're welcome.
So first, tell me, what does the Special Service team do?
Special Services caters to the population of West Virginia that has a visual impairment, blindness, or a physical disability.
So give me a, describe for me a typical day here in the Special Services team.
Days are interesting around here. We're a staff of four currently, and our day starts with mail. The mail comes in, we check all of our cartridges, open the boxes, clean them, make sure that the cartridge matches the outside box labeling. Books are then sorted and put back on the shelf. From that point, we go to our large print. We do the same, very similar process, cleaning things, making sure that books are in good repair. Put those back on the shelf, and then take care of our machines. Make sure those are clean and good repair. Batteries changed, any mechanical issues that those are having. And then we go in and take care of reader's advisory. Patrons call in all day long, and we are constantly making sure that they're getting the books and the materials that they need. The afternoon comes around, we kind of do the reverse process. We print our patron requests, and they come out on nice little cards. We go into the back stacks, we pull the books and put them in the mail to go out in the afternoon.
What else do you do?
We have descriptive video.
What is descriptive video? I've heard that term before. What is that?
Descriptive video is, it's just like a movie that you or I would watch. However, in the pauses and the blank spaces that things are happening that you see or I see, but someone that can't see, they take and describe those moments. So maybe they're describing what you have on, or they're describing that someone walked across the room and back. All those little fine details that we catch with our eyes, but our patrons can't see those.
That's neat.
It's really cool.
How many folks are we talking about in the state that depend on you guys?
We have just under 3,000 patrons in the state of West Virginia, which is only about 10% of the blind and visually impaired, physically impaired population in the state.
So describe the process. Someone who is blind, someone who is dyslexic, they want to take advantage of the services you guys provide. What's the process? What do they have, steps do they have to take to get involved?
The process is very simple. We are a branch of the Regional National Library Service, so there's a general application that comes from the Library of Congress. We have copies of those here. The public library has those. They're available online, either on our website or from the Library of Congress. They fill out this application. It's really simple. It's just basic information, name, address, telephone number. Someone has to certify their disability. Now, if it's dyslexia or it's a issue like that, then a doctor does have to certify those. However, if it is blindness, a visual impairment, or physical impairment that's easily identifiable, then anybody can certify that. A librarian, a pastor, a social worker, anybody that works with these people on a daily basis. can sign off and authorize it. The third page of the application is simply, do you want me to send books that I pick for you, or do you want to call me and tell me what you want? There's options to check what kind of books you like. You sign it and send it in.
What about newspapers, magazines? Can the blind take advantage of those kinds of things?
Yes, we do offer magazines and newspapers that are on cartridge. Depending on what types of magazines you like, we have a wide variety of magazines that are available. The magazines are sent out, and then you send those back in to get your next month. Newspapers are a little different. We have a phone-in service called Newsline. The patrons are eligible for that. It's a totally free service. It's an 800 number. They pick up the phone, dial in, and choose what newspapers they want to listen to. There's national papers. There's international papers. There's 11 West Virginia papers are on there. There's shopping circulars, job listings, even the weather. It's a very comprehensive service. It's great.
One thing I would really like to see is how the audiobooks work. Can you show us that?
Absolutely. Let's take a look and let John, our machine coordinator, show us how that works.
Okay. Okay, John. Let's take a look at how these audiobooks work. Why don't you show me first the audiobook machine?
Okay. Well, this is the digital talking book player. It's designed in a way that it's very intuitive for anyone using it. It has Braille here on the buttons. All of the buttons are raised in specific ways, so it's very tactile. That way it's usable for both sighted and blind. And if you just turn it on here, with the power button.
Player on. Press any button to learn about its.
And the audio, the audio is very important hours. For a book like this, obviously, right?
It is. A lot of the functions of the machine are done audibly, so that it's very clear what's happening.
Okay, why don't you show me how what the buttons do?
Okay, well, already said that's the power button.
Okay.
The buttons down here are generally used to control the book itself. This rewinds the book.
Okay.
Rewind. Press this rewind button once.
This will fast forward the book.
Fast forward. Press this fast forward button once.
This is the play button here in the middle.
Play, stop. To start or stop playing a book.
And this is the sleep button. This is actually used in case a patron wants to put the book to sleep after a certain period of time. It's set in 15-minute increments.
Okay.
Sleep. Pressing the sleep button once will play 15 minutes of the book, and then stop.
But then the buttons up here and off to the side, this is the volume button. It'll control the volume of the book. It won't adjust anything while there's no book in it.
Okay.
And same with the tone, to change the tone of the narrator for the book. And the speed, which will speed the book up.
Gotcha. Okay. So right now there is no book in there.
There is not.
So show me how that works. You have a book. What do we do next?
Okay. Well, if we take the book out of the case here, this is what we send them in. And we just slide it right in here like this. The only way it'll go in, it's designed so that it won't fit in any other way. There's no way to mess that up. Go right in there.
O'Hurley's Return.
Okay.
By Nora Roberts.
And then you can
8319.
Pause it, play it, rewind it, whatever you need to do.
I do want to mention, too, that I see that you're wearing gloves.
I am, yes. I deal with the machines all day. They come back, they come in, covered in dust from the mail, and we want to make sure the books or the machines are cleaned and taken care of so that when they're sent back out to patrons, they're brand new, fresh.
Okay. Have a number of tools I see beside the book machine. What do you use the tools for?
Most of them are just used to remove the battery pack on the back.
Gotcha.
But some of them are also used to take the whole machine apart so I can do any maintenance inside around the around the motherboard or even the speaker.
I would assume at some point you're going to get damaged books and probably damaged machines. What do you do in those cases?
In the case that it's too damaged, we actually have a procedure in place to send it back to NLS. Otherwise, we have replacement parts and things that we can go ahead and replace it with and switch things out so that we can get the machine back in working order.
Okay. I'm looking over here to my left. I see some other machinery and some other devices. What do we have over here?
Well, I mentioned the batteries, and the machine can run off of battery and power cord. These are the batteries that have come back that didn't work. So what I use these machines here for is to recondition the batteries so that they can be sent back out and repurposed.
How many books do you process? I mean, how many machines do you process typically in a day?
Usually between 2 and 5.
Then how many books?
Between 200 and 400.
That's a lot of books.
Yes, it is. John, quite a bit of work.
John, appreciate the tour. Thanks very much.
Absolutely. Okay.
You know, Jasmine, as I realized talking with you and John, that you two are half of the department. And it's a lot of work to do for four people. I know you depend on volunteers for a lot of work, and you have volunteers coming in. Tell me about that program.
Absolutely. We have volunteers that come in from several different agencies throughout the community. Kanawha County Public Schools sends us volunteers, Job Corps, Job Squad. We also have volunteers that come in that have worked here previously, and people that just come in from out of the community that want to donate their time to help us to serve our purpose here in the library, to help people with disabilities and special needs.
One of the things I realized as I was talking to John, talking with you, is that you must have hundreds and hundreds of audiobooks. Where do you keep them?
Oh, Stan, we have thousands of books. Let me show you.
Okay, let's go. Well, you mentioned thousands and thousands of books, and by golly, there sure are thousands of them.
Absolutely.
So one of the things I'm interested in is, where do they come from? Where do you get the books that you use and give to patrons?
Our books come to us from the National Library Service, which is NLS. It's a division of the Library of Congress. So all of our books come to us essentially from Washington, D.C.
How expensive is it? Are these free to the library? Does the library pay for them? How does that process work?
Now, these are all free to us. They are provided through the Library of Congress and the federal grant money. But now, we also do record-on-demand cartridges. And those cartridges we have to buy. They look a little different than these. They're green. And they cost us about $8 a cartridge. So the books that we send out that we make are expensive. So if we're making magazines and books, the ones that we make here in-house, they're costly.
You know, the thing that I realize too, as I'm looking through all the books and doing what you do, this is a pretty important job.
Absolutely.
In your estimation, how big a job, how important a job is this?
You know, I told you earlier that we've been told we're the best kept secret in West Virginia, and that breaks my heart, because our patrons love to read, they love to learn, they love to read a book, magazine, just the same as you do, or I do, or any other person in the world does that's sighted. It's important to remember that our patrons have a disability, but a disability is just a medical diagnosis. There's more in common between you and that person with a disability than there is that's uncommon. So being able to provide our patrons a means to read just in an alternate format it's incredibly important. It helps them maintain their independence. It helps to keep them a anchored part of society. It helps them to feel important, and that means all the world.
Jasmine, I want to thank you and the Special Services team for giving us the guided tour and explaining to everyone exactly what you do.
You're very welcome. I'm glad we had you in.
Thanks, Jasmine.
You're welcome.
We're going to take a break. We'll be right back after this.
Welcome to Understood.org, a free online resource for parents of kids with learning and attention issues, with personalized recommendations, tools, and daily access to experts to help your child thrive. Understood.org, because understanding is everything.
Welcome back to Libraries Today, where we're learning about some of the services that WVLC provides the state. We're here in the Culture Center in Charleston in the State Library, operated by the WVLC's State Library Services. Library Services provides state agencies, the legislature, libraries across the state, and the public with traditional and digital library services. This includes this library internet access for lawmakers, state employees, and the public, research assistance, access to federal government documents, and a lot more. With me now to explain the role of State Library Services and to give us a tour of the facility is Library Services Director Heather Campbell-Shock. Heather, thanks for being with us.
Thanks, Dan. Thanks for having me.
You know, the State Library is probably the most visible aspect of the WVLC.
Mm-hmm.
When people come in, this is kind of the face of the commission. So tell me about what you do here.
Well, this particular library, it functions very similar to a traditional public library in your communities. We provide resources, both print and electronic. We provide a lot of audiobooks, a lot of recreational material for the lawmakers, so when they're not doing their business over at the Capitol, they can come over here, get leisure reading, watch movies, get audiobooks.
Do some research, I would imagine.
Oh, too. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Do some research. We also provide collections to school libraries, which don't always have the biggest budgets for their collections, and that way we can help provide their students with the best resources. We also provide collections to public libraries, mostly our audiobook collections, which we'll see in a bit, so they can help supplement their resources. We provide, as you said, internet, Wi-Fi, we have a notary service, we have free copying, free faxing, so we provide basically everything that a public library would provide.
Well, why don't you show me around?
All right, well, how about we start with one of the more popular places in the library, the magazine nook.
Okay.
It's right over here. We subscribe to about 200 print magazines in this particular area, as well as electronic magazines that's available on phones, digital tablets, your computer. And a lot of the people come in here just to sit, relax. It's a bit off from everything. It's quiet, and they can peruse the magazines as needed. Or use the Wi-Fi services over here.
How do you select the magazines you have here?
We select the magazines based on whether or not they focus on West Virginia, what kind of economic or political information they provide. We also have a lot of accounting, and we have a lot of just kind of leisure magazines like People, Car and Driver, Cycle World, just to kind of help break the monotony of research and provide that little bit of leisure reading.
Why don't you show us some other areas?
All right. If you'll come this way, you'll see our reference collection. Our reference collection basically has information on grants, legal information, statistical information about West Virginia, the United States, and international statistics. And that will be located here, and in the back is our map section. To keep on going, we do have a small graphic novel collection, and this is mostly used by schools, helping students who aren't interested in reading to get interested in reading, because everyone likes comics, so it helps build that reading interest, and it helps them build their vocabulary and confidence in reading. Right in front of us here, are our online public access computers that anyone can come into the library and use.
Do you need to have a library card or anything to access?
Right away, no. We do allow guest passes, but if we notice you coming in more frequently than once or twice, we do ask that you get a library card to log in. We also have a couple of display areas throughout the library that allows us to show different types of material.
Dr. Seuss.
Dr. Seuss had a birthday at the mm-hmm. beginning of March, so we still have that display up.
You mentioned that you can have a guest pass, but eventually you want folks to have library cards.
Yes.
How do you get one?
Basically, we try to make it as simple as possible since we are a library for government employees who aren't always on the Capitol complex. If you are available to come into the library, we ask that you do that with some form of valid ID. If you're a state employee off the Capitol complex, you can shoot us an email and we will take your contact information, create your card, and send it out with an information packet about our services and resources.
What do we have on this end of the library?
At this end of the library is the bulk of our audiobook collection. We do have a very huge collection. We do not collect fiction the way a normal public library would, because we are mostly of a research library. So most of our fiction is available in CD or downloadable format. Most of our commuters prefer to listen to audiobooks from their favorite fiction authors. So we do have a very large collection, as you can see, to help accommodate those individuals. We have a much smaller nonfiction and biography section on audio. So mostly people like to read that in print.
So we've talked about traditional books and audio books, and we have movies and graphic novels. One of the services you just recently launched is called Hoopla.
Yes.
What is that?
Hoopla is a digital way to get comic books, ebooks, audiobooks, television shows, and movies at home on your computer or device like a Kindle Fire, an iPad, or a Samsung device.
What do you need to be able to access it?
In order to access it, you would need to have a library card with us, and we would send you information about accessing Hoopla from there, the URL, for example, and how to log in. And from there, our customers can check out 10 items from Hoopla in a month, so they can listen to more audiobooks, read more ebooks, or watch TV if they want to.
So really, with a card, I can watch movies and to do a lot of the things that you can do on the internet just with a library card.
Absolutely, and for free. So we do
It's pretty cool.
It is very cool, and we like to tell people that you don't have to pay for some of these other subscriptions because we can provide it for free.
One other service you also recently launched was called Self-E for Authors.
Yes.
What is that about?
Self-E is a way for individuals who write materials, books, independent authors to get their work out there to be reviewed by a library book reviewer. That way they can get the work out there. And then the books that are submitted go into our BiblioBoard ebook platform. So anyone within the state can read West Virginia authors' ebooks through this service. Through Self-E, they also give the works, like I said earlier, to professional reviewers to take a look at their work, write reviews in a magazine that librarians use across the country to select books, and that's called Library Journal. And Library Journal selected authors' works are available through BiblioBoard across the nation. So that really helps expose really great works by West Virginia authors nationwide. We are a culture of storytellers, so this is a great way to allow West Virginia stories to get out there to the nation and other public libraries.
A lot of what the public sees is what we've just taken a look at.
Yes.
But much of what you folks do is behind the scenes in the stacks.
Absolutely.
Let's go take a look at that.
All right.
We're here in the stacks, third floor of the Culture Center, with research librarian Lisa Hacheski. So Lisa, tell me about what we have up here.
This is our physical collection. We have fiction, juvenile and adult fiction. We have back here are our nonfiction.
It goes a long way. It's a lot of books.
There's a lot of books. Our collection is quite large. And we have...
My favorite section.
Your favorite
history.
Section. History.
History. It's right there.
Okay.
Yes.
mostly these are the books that we circulate to the public. And
the public can come up here. This is not... the library is the first floor of the Culture Center. This is the third floor. So the public can come up here and access these books.
Yes. All they have to do is come to the front desk and ask us that they want to come up to the stacks, and we'll be glad to send you up here and look to your heart's content.
So traditional books in this area, here on the third floor, you also have plenty of federal documents and newspapers. What else do you have?
Well, we are a federal depository for federal documents, so we have a very large collection here.
What does that mean?
That means the federal documents that the government produces, they send them to certain libraries across the country for housing, and we are one of those libraries.
So for research, lawmakers in the state legislature
yes.
would frequent that area probably
yes.
quite a bit.
Yes, so and we also have a microfilm of our newspaper collections, and we have journals and serials.
I notice newspapers, stacks of newspapers as well. So mm-hmm. where do the newspapers come from, all across the state?
Yes, across the state. We have a couple of like New York Times, Washington Post, Columbus Dispatch, a couple regional things too.
Lisa, thanks for your time
Thank
and
you.
Thanks for the tour. Obviously, there's a lot more than meets the eye when you're talking about the state library.
Yes.
Since its start 88 years ago, the West Virginia Library Commission has committed itself to improving and enriching library services for all West Virginians. When the WVLC started, there were only 26 libraries in the entire state. Now there are 172. Libraries in West Virginia have come a long way over the years, and the WVLC's role is more important now than ever. Today we learned about two of the vital functions of the WVLC. Special services and its role in giving the visually challenged a window to the world of reading, and library services, which operates the state library here in Charleston. I'd like to thank our guest today, special services librarian Jasmine Lewis Combs and her teammate John Barker, as well as library services director Heather Campbell Schock and research librarian Lisa Hacheski. Thanks to everyone for the guided tour.
The West Virginia Library Commission encourages lifelong learning, individual empowerment, civic engagement, and an enriched quality of life by enhancing library and information services for all West Virginians. For questions or comments regarding topics on this show, please do not hesitate to call us at 1-800-642-9021 or visit us online at www.librarycommission.wv.gov. To keep you updated on library happenings in the state and beyond, the West Virginia Library Commission uses the WVLC website, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube channel, and the Library Lookout newsletter. If you haven't liked us or followed us on social media yet, please do.
Every child is curious.
George, look what I found.
Turn their curiosity into a lifelong love of learning. Create a curious reader.
This is super bedtime reading.
Share a book together today. Visit read.gov.
I'm your host, Stan Howe. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Libraries Today.